Well, good morning, everybody. It's Pastor Ross here, and I'm actually recording this Thursday before Church in the Park because I know there's some people who aren't going to be able to be there on Sunday at the park, and so if you weren't there, this is for you. This is so you can still hear the closing message of my whole middleman series that we've been going through. We're going to talk about baptism as part of this message today, and we did baptisms at the park on this Sunday, but if you want to be baptized, come and tell us, and we will figure out a time to get you baptized or talk about the next time we're going to be doing baptisms here at the church. Today, I'm going to wrap up the middleman series, and so if you're sitting next to somebody at your house or wherever you're at, turn to them and say, "You're a middleman." We started the summer talking about average everyday people and how they did really incredible things for God, even though they didn't get much credit for it. And so anyway, just a quick recap. We started out the summer talking about John the Baptist and how he was this big player, but then was quickly overshadowed by Jesus. Andrew the disciple, he was with Jesus when they were going to feed the 5,000, or Jesus was prepared to, and all the other disciples said, "Oh, you can't do this," but Andrew, he had faith in Jesus, and so he said, "Here's these fish and loaves I got from this boy. I believe you can do it," and Jesus did this miracle. Huge thing, but Andrew doesn't get any credit. Hannah, who had always wanted a child, and she was barren, and she was faithful to the Lord, even when things were really tough, and she had a lot of people pushing against her, and she stuck it out with the Lord, and the Lord blessed her with a baby boy, and she dedicated him to the Lord, and he became Samuel, one of the greatest prophets of all time. And then we talked about Aaron, the brother of Moses, and I mentioned this multiple times, but Moses really didn't do a whole lot. Aaron did it all. I mean, God came to Moses and instructed Moses to go, but since Moses couldn't speak well and was afraid that he wouldn't do a good enough job for God, God led Aaron to go with him, and Aaron was his middleman. He spoke to Pharaoh. He orchestrated the plagues, and he's the one who waved his staff over the waters, and they turned to blood. Aaron did it all, even though Moses gets all the credit. And then in July, we switched gears and started talking about prophets, and we talked about two in July. We talked about Nathan, who confronted David about his sin when he took Bathsheba as his wife and orchestrated the murder of her husband Uriah. God called Nathan to confront David, and David had to face repentance. And we know that David was a man after God's own heart, and so what we ended up experiencing and reading and what David went through was this moment of repentance for the sin that he was in. Now, even though he repented, there were consequences. And so sometimes there's consequences. Even when God gives us forgiveness for something that we've done sinful, sometimes there's still earthly consequences. But what's so cool is because Nathan was willing to be the middleman, when David had one of his next sons, not Bathsheba's son, but his other wife's son, he named that son after Nathan. And so Nathan, in a way, was adopted into the lineage that ended up producing the Messiah, Jesus. And so if you go from Jesus and go backwards through his lineage, you'll hear about Nathan, David's son, who is named after the prophet, who was faithful to be a middleman for God. Then we talked about Micaiah, and Micaiah was a prophet for King Ahab, and Ahab was not a good king. He didn't really follow what the Lord led anytime a prophet came to him, and so in the same manner, when Micaiah came and said, "Ahab, you should not go to battle against that enemy," God says you shouldn't go, even though all the other advisors were saying to go. He said, "If you go, God says you will go to your death." And Ahab, instead of listening to the Lord through Micaiah, Ahab goes to war anyway, and sure enough, he walks right into battle, and he dies in the battle. And so, you know, I kind of challenge you and said, are you listening to the Lord? Are you listening to the voice of the Lord in your life? And if you are, then you'll walk into more life, abundant life in God. But if you're not listening to God's leading, you may be walking into death situations in your life. And whether that's real death, like physical death or emotional or spiritual or any of those things. So we need to be following the word of the Lord. We need to be following what the Lord's leading us to do. And then this month we started talking about Jesus, okay, and how he was the ultimate middleman. Now, No one out-middlemans Jesus as the middleman. The first week we talked about how Jesus brought us salvation, about how he brought us a life of freedom and a life of fullness. And when we're talking about freedom, we're talking about freedom from the condemnation of our sin, the punishment of living sinfully. We deserve punishment. We deserve to go to hell for our sins, but Jesus defeated the grave for us so we wouldn't have to do that. And that's something to get excited about. And when we talk about him saying that we'll live a full or abundant life, we're talking about when we're doing or we're living the life that Jesus, that God has created for us, it is the most fulfilling. It is the most abundant. Now, every situation might not feel that way, but in the end, when you fulfill the destiny that was originally written by the author God for you, it is incredibly fulfilling. And so that's the kind of fullness we're talking about. So anyway, last week then, we talked about what Jesus is doing for us today. He's fighting for us in heaven right now. In a courtroom drama from heaven, Jesus is up there as our defense lawyer, and he's interceding for us. When the devil, who is trying to accuse us of our current sins and the things that we do, even though we're believers, and the devil is able to go up there and look at God and say, God, these people, even though they say they accepted you, they're sinners. Jesus stands in the gap and he says, no. He said, I have paid the price for them. He's fighting for us right now. And the thing that we kind of closed with last week that I want to just hit on before I get into today and wrapping this series up, is that Jesus encourages us to pray in his name. His name, the name of Jesus, is the name above all names. It is the most powerful name. At his name, the devil has to flee. And so the Bible, the word, Jesus, when he's speaking, he encourages us to pray in the name of Jesus, to use his name. Because we made him Lord of our life, we now have been given the authority to use that name here on earth. So let me just make this as simple as I can. In hell, he defeated the grave for us. In heaven, he's fighting and speaking to the Father about us. And here on earth, right now, every day, he's given us the authority to use the power of his name. Jesus is the ultimate middleman. Now, there's one last thing I want to talk about, and there's many I could talk about with Jesus, but there's one last thing I'd like to talk about before I'm done with the series that Jesus has done for us. But before I get to it, why don't we bow our heads and let's pray. Father, thank you so much for everybody who's watching today, everybody who's connecting with us, and God, no matter where they're at, in a different state, in a different country, or right here in our own hometown, God, I just pray that you are there in their midst, and that as we get into your word and we talk about Jesus in this end of this middleman series, that you will speak to us, and we will have ears that hear your voice, we'll have hearts that understand what you're trying to tell us, and minds that desire to live out the instruction that you're speaking to us. God, I also just pray that you filter me out of this and that this really is focused on who you are and what you want today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so what I would like to focus on today is that when Jesus lived, when he walked through his ministry, he did so really to be an example or a teacher for us. He was a middleman because he showed us how to live. And not only did he show us, but he would teach it, and then he would use his life as an example to show us how to do it. You know, school is just about to start. Many people are starting this coming week here. And I think about all the teachers, and I think about how each teacher is really a middleman for the future life of the young boys and girls that are going to school right now. They're standing in the gap in their lives between being a child, a kid being a child, and a kid being an adult. And they're not just, a great teacher isn't just teaching the concept and hoping the kid understands it. They're teaching the concept, but then in the classroom and around the school, they're also being examples of it. They're living the examples. I mean, you can't learn math without your teacher first teaching the concept and then also giving example and showing example of how to do the problems correctly. And so Jesus did the same thing. In fact, one of the main titles that Jesus had all through the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four books of the Bible that talk about Jesus' ministry, one of the main titles he gets called all the time is teacher. He was a teacher. So I want to talk about some things that Jesus taught us when he lived and when he was doing his ministry. And I believe I have four of them today, and so I'll do my best to get through all of them. So they're kind of, some of them are going to be shorter because I really want to get to the last one, which really pertains to what's happening at the river today with the baptisms. So the first thing that Jesus showed us is he showed us how to live sin-free. It seems impossible, but Jesus did it. He lived sin-free, and he told us that we should live that way. 1 Peter 2, 21 through 22 says this. It says, "To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example," everybody say example, "that you should follow in his steps." And what are the steps that he was walking in? Here it is, verse 22. "He committed no sin." No sin. None. And it says, "And no deceit was found in his mouth." So he didn't live sin and he didn't speak sin. Okay? And this is the footsteps or the steps that we're told we're supposed to follow in our lives too. And I know that seems tough, but if you remember, how many times did Jesus heal somebody or minister to somebody or have an amazing moment with somebody, and at the end of his conversation with them, what he told them to do was go and what? Sin no more. And so Jesus, he believes we can do it. And he believes it, and he shows us it because he lived in such a way that he had no sin. And so he believes that with him in our lives, we can live a sin-free life. Okay, and I realize we all make mistakes, and that there's times where we sin. And I mean, every week, or not every week, but often I say that, you know, all of us sin, and you know, we probably all sinned this last week. And some of us, you know, we struggle more than others. But we need to be striving to live sin free. And Jesus is an example to us that we can do that. Okay, so let's work at that. Let's see him as the example. And when we know we're walking into sinful situations, let's remember that Jesus showed us that we can do this. The second thing that Jesus taught us is he showed us how to love other people. John 13:34 says this. It says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another." So again, he's using himself as an example. He's teaching a command, and then he's saying, but what does that look like? It's the way that I've cared for you. And then he says this, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." So real quick side note is there were lots of rabbis that had disciples. There were lots of people who traveled around and they taught the law concepts, the things from what we call the Old Testament now. But the thing about those leaders is that the law and the rules were everything, and the people were secondary. We as their thought was that we as people, we were made to follow the rules. And that was it. And so Jesus blew people's minds. And because he said, you know, the rules are very important, but loving one another is at the apex, at the most important part of who we are. And this is what made him different. And so when he says this, "By this, everyone will know you are my disciples," he means it, and they understand that because he is unlike anybody else who ever was a rabbi and had disciples following him. So it was different for them to love people unconditionally. And so if they would continue to love the way that he did, people would know they must have followed Jesus because he's the only rabbi who loved people that way. You know, Jesus literally says, "This is the way that the world needs to see you and me, is through love." And he didn't just say to love, he said, "I'm the example." And we see this throughout the Gospels. We see that Jesus spent time with people who the rest of the world thought were worthless. He spent his time with people who were his enemies, and he loved those people. He cared for those people. You know, I think about what's going on in our world today, and Christians, to be critical of ourselves, because we need to be constructively critical of our lives. Christians are so hard set against other religious groups of people. Sadly, even when sometimes we see things like what's going on in the Middle East right now happening, we don't have compassion for those people. But you know, when Jesus ran into the Samaritan woman, she was the same kind of cultural enemy, religious enemy, as a Christian might feel towards people of the Muslim faith. And instead of saying, I'm going to separate from that person, or that person is evil to me, or they're my opposition or my enemy, Jesus ministers to that woman. And so he shows us that he loves people unconditionally in every circumstance. You know, you can't change the world through argument, but you can change the world through love. People are drawn to love. People want to be around people who show them love. And so Jesus just is the greatest example of this, and we need to take a note out of his playbook and love people no matter what. We need to be praying for Afghanistan. We need to be praying for those people over there every day. They need to be on our heart. We, you know, there's songs and there's scripture verses that say, break my heart for what breaks yours. His heart is breaking for those people, and our hearts should break too. So I challenge you to love people the way Jesus loved people. The third thing that Jesus taught us and showed us is that Jesus showed us how to love God. If you remember that time there, that Jesus was challenged by one of the Pharisees, like a person who knew the law, the Old Testament rules in and out, he challenged Jesus, said, what's the most important commandment? And he knows that if Jesus picks one, then he's saying the other ones aren't important, and that's a problem. And it was just one of the traps they were trying to set. And this is what Jesus responded with. In Luke 10:27, he answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And, he says, love your neighbor as yourself. We already talked about the love your neighbor part, but Jesus is the example of this love the Lord your God with everything in you. I mean, he gives his life for God's plan. He gives every effort of who he is for God's plan. He's willing to surrender himself even to the cross for God's plan. He gave it all. And when people, before he even went to the cross, when people would try to give Jesus credit for the miracles that were happening and the things that were happening all around him, the signs and wonders, he just kept saying, it's not me, it's the Father who is in me. It's my Father in heaven. Without my Father, I would be nothing. Without my Father, you know, and he just keeps pointing people to the Father. That's what loving God is all about. It's saying, hey, I've surrendered myself to the point of my heart, my soul, my strength, my mind. I've surrendered all those things in such a great way to the Lord that nothing I do I want credit for. I want to give it all to God. I want him to have all the credit for who I am and for why I am and for what I am. Every one of those things, that he's the reason we live. Jesus didn't try to be the main man. He told people all the time, in his own words, I am the middle man. I'm not the main man. I'm the middle man. So he showed us how to love God with full submission. And again, like in these other categories, I challenge you, are you fully submitted to God as your Father, as your Creator, as your Lord? And are you willing to give him credit above everything else? Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about today, and I'm going to put some focus into this, is the thing that Jesus taught us is that Jesus showed us the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're sitting next to somebody, say, the Holy Spirit. And I know people get really weirded out about the concept of the Holy Spirit, but there is nothing weird about the Holy Spirit. Jesus, when he's with the disciples and he's about to go into heaven, he says, you should not try to go minister to people. You shouldn't try to carry out God's plan until you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, until you've been anointed by the Holy Spirit, okay? And so Jesus is really clear that the Holy Spirit is an important, integral part of being used by God. And so I want to talk about this for a few minutes. So today we're going to have baptisms in the river, or Sunday we're having baptisms in the river. And why are we doing that? Well, because Jesus is the example for us. He got baptized, and so we believe that we should get baptized. When we read in Acts, we read that new believers, they would get saved, they make Jesus Lord of their life, and then they would be baptized. It was something that came after salvation. So a lot of people ask, you know, should I be water baptized? I was baptized as a baby and all of that stuff. And you know, I don't want to ruffle any feathers or anything like that. I'm not like I really care that much. But I believe it's important that you make a willing decision to get baptized. And so you can't do that as an infant. It's a nice thing your parents did for you. There's reasons historically why that started. It was not a biblically started thing originally with babies. The example we see in the Bible every time is it's after you make Jesus Lord of your life. So you need to be older. So if you've never been baptized, love to baptize you. And so we'd like to connect and come talk to us. We'll get you baptized. But we're going to do this. And something happened to Jesus when he got baptized. It says in the Word that the Holy Spirit descended on him, and the Bible says like a dove, or it alighted on him. It basically rested on him. And it empowered him to do all of these miraculous things that he did. Now, when Jesus did miracles, we just talked about it, he gave credit to the Father. But he did those miracles through the power of the Holy Spirit. You'll find that he really didn't do any amazing things, no miracles, no nothing, before this moment when he got baptized and the Holy Spirit came upon his life. And that is because every miracle, every time he read somebody's mail and they were like, wow, how'd you know that? Every time he did something amazing, every time he calmed a storm or cast out a demon, it was through the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of God working through him in the form of the Holy Spirit. You know, something you might find interesting, and I think this is interesting, is that in Jesus' time, a Jew only had one name. Only one. They didn't have multiple names. And so when we read about like Simon Peter or Matthew, whose name was originally Levi, the name that they ended up with, the reason why there's two names is because when Rome took control, people started to have not just a Jewish name, but they had a Greek name too. And so anyway, forget all that. When Jesus was born, he was just Jesus. Everybody say, just Jesus. He was just Jesus. And, you know, in his hometown, people who knew his dad was Joseph, they would say, Jesus, Joseph's son. That's where the last names like that have come, Williamson or Johnson, because those names are, historically a father's name and then son. And so that's what Jesus would have been known as. And when Jesus would have traveled outside of the city, and you hear this many times, he would be identified from the city that he lives in. So he lived in Nazareth, and so he would be called Jesus of Nazareth. Okay, but the name that we know him as is not Jesus of Nazareth or Jesus Joseph's son. We know him as Jesus Christ. Everybody say Christ. Okay, that word Christ, if we trace that back to the original language that would have been used in Jesus' day, that word is translates into Christos, and then that's the Greek word, which was translated out of a Hebrew word, which means the anointed one. And the first person to declare that Jesus was the anointed one was John the Baptist, all the way back to the very first message that we taught in this series. John the Baptist is the one who said he saw the Holy Spirit come down on him. And God told John the Baptist, he said, when you see this happen, you need to point out that that's the Messiah, that that's my anointed one to save the world. And so Jesus Christ means Jesus the anointed one, the one that will carry the power of God and carry out the mission of God. And so through water baptism, God anoints Jesus with the power to carry out God's purpose. And today I believe that when we get in, or on Sunday, when we got in the water or get in the water to baptize people, I believe that that same thing happens for each one of us. I think there's people who want to be used by God. There's Christ followers who've made Jesus Lord of their life. And they want to be used by God, but they feel like they're up against a wall, that there's frustration or whatever, and they feel like they can't break through this thing. And I would just like to challenge you and say that the thing that you're missing is the Holy Spirit leading you. See, Jesus didn't do anything on his own. He didn't take control of it on his own. He was always surrendered to the Father, and the Father then led him through the Holy Spirit. So this is what happened with Jesus, and I believe it'll happen when you get baptized, when you choose to get water baptized as an adult. Water baptism is an awesome part of a Christ follower's life. Now, I would like to be clear. It is not something that gets you to heaven. It's something that empowers you on earth. Water baptism is the thing that empowers you to live the life that God created for you. When you got saved, you started in that direction. And God's Spirit was with you and around you and in you. But this is like getting another dose of this. So I want to just close this time together by explaining what happened to Jesus in the water that day. There were three things the Bible talks about. It says that when Jesus came up out of the water, God the Father saw this happen. It says that the heavens opened. That's one. It says that the Holy Spirit descended or alighted or rested on him as a dove. That's two. And it says that God the Father, from heaven, a voice came down and said, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased." And I believe that every time a Christ follower gets baptized, that those three things happen again. Because Jesus is the example. That when you get water baptized, when you come out of the water, heaven is opened and you gain a whole new access to the gifts of God. The Bible talks about the fruits of the Spirit, right? So you have new access to the fruits of the Spirit, new access to the Father that you didn't have before. I believe that the Holy Spirit comes down and rests on you and empowers you for ministry. That it empowers you to be used to actually walk out what God's plan is for your life. And then the third thing that happens that I think maybe is the most significant, I think the Holy Spirit is right at the top of the list. But to hear and to know that God the Father is looking down from his heavenly place and he's looking at you and he says, "This is my Son. This is my daughter, in whom I'm well pleased." I think that is something that is one of the most powerful things that can ever happen in anyone's life. I have a sister who, I hadn't planned on saying this, so I guess I'm going to add this into Sunday's message since it's Thursday before Sunday. I have a sister who is adopted, and when she was adopted into our family, she was older. She was like 16, and she had a last name. She had a life that she had lived up to that moment. And I had moved out of the house. I was in college. And so for me, it was different coming home and having this girl in our house, a girl who was calling my mom and dad, mom and dad. And, you know, she made a choice that she wanted to be part of our family. And we love her, and we're so happy that she did that. And we welcomed her in. We encouraged her to be part of our family. She changed her last name to be our last name. And so she officially was part of our family. And I think, I mean, I don't know because I'm not in her head, but there's one, it means something for somebody to say, "I want to be part of your family," and for us to say, "Great, we love that. Make the choice to change your name. You know, let's do this. We want you to be part of our family." But it's a whole nother thing when the parents of that family look at you and say, "You're the daughter," or "You're the son that I love so dearly." It's a whole nother thing to hear your heavenly Father and to know that your heavenly Father, you chose to be part of the family. You said, "Yes, I want Jesus." But it's a whole nother thing when you know that God the Father says, "And I choose you too. And I'm proud of you. And I've got great things in store for you." This is what happens when you get baptized. This is why we celebrate baptism. This is why it's so significant. Because God loves you and he wants to empower you to live the fullest life you could, the life he created for you.
Why don't we bow our heads real quick and we're going to pray. Father, thank you so much for everybody who's watching this today. Thank you that Jesus was the ultimate middleman, that he did all of these things for us, that he defeated the grave, that he's fighting for us in heaven, that he gives us the power, the authority to use his name here, that he was a great example for us, that he was a great teacher for us, that he showed us how to live. And God, I pray that it will inspire each one of us to take notes from Jesus' playbook, the way that he lived, and to live that way. God, inspire us. And thank you that you've also chosen us. That this isn't just a bandwagon we jumped on. No, it's a home that we have been invited into where you value us as your children. With everybody's eyes closed, if you're at home right now, I want to give you the opportunity. If you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, I want to give you the opportunity to say, I want to make him Lord of my life. I want all of this. I want to be part of that family. I want to know that I have a God who cares about me, who sees me, who values me. If that's you, God is right there in the room with you. The Holy Spirit is right there in the room with you. And we're going to pray, and you just declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord of your life, that you're going to surrender to him and allow him to lead you where God wants you to go. So we're going to pray this prayer. If you pray this prayer for the first time, in the comment section, I want you, after we're done praying, to put in there, I prayed this prayer because we want to connect you with you and make sure we help you take the next steps in God's direction. Maybe the next step for you will be getting baptized. As soon as we can get you baptized. All right, so let's pray this together. Pray this with me. Say, Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross, defeat the grave, and to rise again. Today I choose to make Jesus Lord of my life. I don't want to live my way anymore. I want to live your way. So lead me into the life you created for me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. Well, I'm so happy that you joined us online, even if you missed being at the park or if you're in another state and you couldn't be here. And our prayer here is that doing these live stream services, that you're able to not just connect with us, but connect with the Lord, to grow deeper with him, to see life change happen. You are so valuable to us because you're so valuable to the Lord. And so don't ever hesitate to reach out or to connect to us or to call the church if you need anything at any time, anywhere. Get a hold of us because we love you and God does too. So hope to see you next week, whether it's in person or online, as we start our new series. And I'm getting pretty excited about it. So we'll see you then. Have a great week.